a 150% rise in the Chinese government's persecution of Christians in just 1 year.
We don't carry arms. We will not carry arms. We don't teach carrying arms. But we can call on God. Our God is bigger than human ammunition.
Hey everybody, welcome back to The Fifth Seal, episode 15. I'm your host, Norm the Master's Dog Dunham, aka The Evangelical Norm. The Fifth Seal is a podcast to bring awareness and prayer to our brothers and sisters around the world who are persecuted because of their faith in Jesus Christ. Every year I count down the top 50 countries on Open Doors USA's World Watch List. From January to October, twice a month, I count down from 50 to 31, and then throughout the month of November, which I dubbed to be Persecuted Church Awareness Month about 10 years ago, I count down from 30 to number 1. It is a countdown, which is why the episode numbers go backwards. You're not crazy. Yesterday was episode 16. Today is 15. Tomorrow will be 14. On to the end of the month when we reach country number 1, which is the worst country in the world for Christians to live in based upon the persecution that they endure for their faith in Jesus Christ. So, all of that being said, a little background on the podcast. It is Tuesday, November 16th, and this is our update on the persecuted church around the world. This from Morningstar News. Pastor slain for refusing to remove church building. Saying a church pastor would, quote, face the wrath from Allah, unquote, for refusing to remove his church building, Muslim extremists in eastern Uganda on October 26 killed him on his animal's grazing field, sources said. Pastor Stephen Luguire of Bunangwe Estate in the predominantly Muslim area of Nangode, Numutumba District, had gone to his fields with his 23-year-old daughter at about 6:30 p.m. When he was killed, she said, he was 58 years old. While Pastor Luguire was untying his sheep from a tree trunk, three men dressed in Islamic attire shouted at them in a language unknown to her, said his daughter, Brenda Luguire. They were brandishing long knives and blunt objects, and one yelled that Pastor Luguire was a kafir, or infidel, who had harmed the religion of Allah, she said. Luguire said that as they approached, one told her father, we have told you to remove the church which is near our mosque, but you have not heeded our message. Today you will face the wrath from Allah, unquote. Pastor Luguire's congregation has worshipped at the building for 2 years. Quote, and then one of the assailants hit my dad with a big stick on the head and he fell down, unquote, Luguire said, adding that she saw another one slashing him with a knife as she fled, terrified. She told her family of the attack and they reported it to police. Officers, local council leaders, and family members arrived at the site early the next day and found the body with deep cuts in the neck and chest. The police and the others learned the suspects had gone to the house of a wealthy Muslim woman identified only as Shimimu, and she was arrested, relatives said. They said Shimimu told police, quote, the servants of Allah entered my house in order to remove the clothes which they were wearing because they were soaked in blood, and said that they had killed an infidel, hence Allah will reward them as they were following the footsteps of their prophet. Furthermore, the pastor didn't honor Allah by refusing to demolish the church, which was close to the mosque, along with his activities of winning their members to Christianity, unquote. The assailants had fled before the police and others arrived. Police have arrested Shamimu and were continuing to search for the assailants, relatives said. Pastor Luguire is survived by his wife, a son, and 7 daughters. A church member, Fred Mukisa Ndjeke, said that the congregation members reported the killings to the area chairperson, a Muslim, and were angered when he did not take it seriously. 2 days after church members held an October 30th funeral for Pastor Luguire, they destroyed the area mosque and other Muslims' property, furthering worsening local tensions, said a local official said. Had it not been for the intervention of the police and local leaders, the whole village could have been on fire, the area official said, on condition of anonymity. The murder was the latest of many instances of persecution of Christians in Uganda that Morningstar News has documented. Uganda's constitution and other laws provide for religious freedom, including the right to propagate one's faith and convert from one faith to another. Muslims make up no more than 12% of Uganda's population, with high concentrations in eastern areas of the country. So, again, it's interesting to read this and to see that church members destroyed a mosque and Muslim properties. Usually you don't see this, and this is not a reaction that we expect. But again, tensions being as high as they are, to have a Muslim council member not take your complaints seriously, the frustration and so on is understandable, but again, not something that we would expect to see from a Christian community. But again, tensions are going to be much higher now. We're likely to see any kind of retaliation back and forth from the Muslims in the area. So pray for this congregation. Pray for the family of Pastor Luguire. Pray that God will strengthen their faith, that God will cause them to restrain themselves from retaliation, that they would turn the other cheek and let their witness of their faith in Christ heap coals upon the heads of those who would persecute them, and we'll continue to pray for them. And that brings us to our World Watch List country for today. Number 15 is the Maldives. The Maldives region is Asia. The persecution type is Islamic oppression. The main religion is Islam. The persecution level is very high. The population is 459,000, of which only a very small number are Christians. We don't even have an estimate. Less than 1,000, probably less than 5,000 in the area. Government is a presidential republic, and the leader is President Ibrahim Mohamed Soliah. So what does persecution look like in the Maldives? What is life like for Christians? The Maldives are viewed by many as a luxury holiday destination, but behind the beauty of this island paradise lies a strict Islamic regime. This chain of nearly 12,000 islands, or 1,200 islands, has one of the highest population densities worldwide, especially on its main island, Male, and close-knit homogeneous communities keep a close watch on their members for any sign of deviation, which naturally includes religious choice. All politicians relentlessly claim that they are keeping the Maldives 100% Muslim, leaving effectively no space for any alternative. Conversion to Christianity can easily result in being reported to Muslim leaders or authorities. Expatriate Christians, most of them working in the tourist sector and coming from India and Sri Lanka, are also closely watched, making Christian fellowship very difficult. The Maldives' place on the World Watch List remains virtually unchanged, demonstrating that very little has altered in the past year. The new government, inaugurated in November 2018, clearly shows no sign of hesitation in its determination to keep the islands entirely free from religious influence that is not Islamic. Persecution mainly takes place away from the eyes of international tourists and the country's economy depends on. A church life in the true meaning of the word is virtually impossible. Converts go to great lengths not to be discovered by their families and communities. They would not only face strong opposition and pressure to return to Islam, but could even lose their citizenship. Prayer points for the Maldives. Pray for the Lord to provide opportunities for believers to gather safely. Pray that God will use the Bible to powerfully strengthen, encourage, and nurture the lives of believers. Pray that attitudes among government officials, especially President Soliah, will soften towards Christians and other religious minorities. Pray for the Christians among expatriate migrant workers, that they can be good witnesses of the hope they have in Christ. Let's pray. Father, thank you again for this time we have to come together to pray for our brothers and sisters around the world who are persecuted because of their faith in you. Lord, we thank you that you have provided for us a social media platform where we can come together across vast distances and even across the span of time, as many people will either watch this video or download a podcast and listen to it later, and yet still join their voices with us as we lift up our brothers and sisters around the world. Lord, we pray for Pastor Luguire's family. We pray that you would bring them peace in the midst of losing their husband, father, pastor, spiritual leader there in that area. We pray for the congregation of that church. Lord, I do specifically pray that you would temper the frustration that they feel, which would cause them to retaliate in a unchristlike way. Lord, I pray that you would help that church to literally turn the other cheek. As hard as that sounds, and as especially in America, as contradictory as that sounds, Lord, we pray that they would let their witness of their faith in you be the beacon for those around them, even to the point as they are willing to stand firm in their faith peacefully in the face of such persecution, that you would use that by your Spirit to draw even those who murdered this man to repentance and faith in you, Lord, and that you would be glorified in that situation. Lord, we lift up our brothers and sisters who are hiding their faith in the Maldives, Lord. We pray that those who are there, that you would give them opportunities to gather together safely, that they can be iron sharpening iron, that they can fellowship together, that you would raise up leaders and pastors and those who could disciple old and new converts, Lord, as they walk in their faith in you in this area where it's so hard to do so. We pray that the words of your word, the words of the Bible, would powerfully strengthen them, encourage them, that it would be exactly what Timothy said it was, and to encourage, rebuke, correct, and instruct, Lord, that it would be, it would literally be the light unto their path. Father, we pray that the attitudes of the government officials, especially President Solis, that you would turn the hearts of the government officials, Lord, that they would soften the restrictions on religious minorities, all of them, and especially those who are believers in Jesus, Lord. And we pray that those who are there from outside areas, from India, from Sri Lanka, that are there just to work, the expatriate migrant worker Christians, Lord, that they would also be a beacon to those, that they would help to disciple those who are new and old believers there in the Maldives, Lord, and that they would also be an example to the Muslim community around them, Lord, that you would use their faith and their proclamation of your gospel to draw Muslims to repentance and faith in you, Lord. And then again, we pray that in all of these things that you would be glorified, because it's for your glory and in your name that we pray these things, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Thank you guys again for taking the time to be part of this. Again, I would ask if you know anybody who's not a part of the Fifth Seal group, not subscribed to the Evangelical Norm channel over on YouTube, invite them. If they're willing to take 15 minutes a day to pray for our brothers and sisters to become more aware of the things that are happening around the world to our brothers and sisters because of their faith in Christ, invite them to join either the Fifth Seal page, the YouTube channel, The Evangelical Norm, or to grab the podcast if they don't have time to watch a video. Download the MP3 podcast, put it in their earphones, take it with them, and keep praying for our brothers and sisters around the world. They can get that anywhere you download an audio podcast. Amazon, Google Play, iTunes, Spotify, any of those places you can get it. And take that podcast with you. Pray for our brothers and sisters around the world. Again, thank you so much. If you haven't already, hit that subscribe button, hit the like and share, so the algorithm will send this out to more and more people who would like to see stuff like this. And as always, preach the gospel at all times. Use words. They're necessary. And until tomorrow, Soli Deo Gloria.